Troy, this is Fake Ned Yost. My favorite opening day memory is going to be my future memory of next year, next opening day in 2012, which Hosmer, Moose, Butler, and Pujols are all on the lineup, and they're all playing first base. Don't ask me how it's going to happen. We'll figure it out. Go Royals.
Right.
For anybody paying attention out there, we are at 31st and Wyandotte in Studio 4 in Kansas City, Missouri at the Casey Ice House. My name is Mike Engel. The Royal Man is not here today. He's doing his roller derby stuff. So I'm joined in studio by Brian McGannon. How's it going, Brian?
It's going well.
Awesome.
Good homestand. I can't complain.
Well, there would be some things you could complain about.
I can't complain about a lot of things.
Yeah, yeah. We go 4-2 against a couple of pretty good teams. Mm-hmm. I mean, the White Sox aren't the best team in the Central, but they're still decent. And, mm-hmm. you know, the Royals look good against them. And first two games of the Rays series, the Royals look almost like a real team, especially once Soria came in the 10th and Hosmer came through last night. That was a really cool game.
That was about as good as we've looked all year, especially since the beginning of the year. I mean, just seeing Hosmer come through like that, and especially Gordon late in games.
Yep.
And I saw they showed it on the broadcast today. Hosmer has 9 game-winning RBIs already. It's safe to say that he has the clutch gene, and he is got. I said it when he came up, when he had that first. He hit a home run late in New York or something like that, and I said on Twitter, I said, I guarantee you that somewhere along the road, no matter who he's playing for, if he's still playing for the Royals, Eric Hosmer is going to hit a big home run in the playoffs for somebody, and I'm hoping that it's going to be the Royals.
Yeah, I hope so. It kind of reminds you of another left-handed slugger that the Royals have had in the past. He had a knack for coming up with the big hit, but I don't want to put that label on him right now, because, I mean, everybody gets that label.
Pump the brakes.
Right, yeah. We can maybe get into that a little bit later. But while you're here, before we set up the show, Brian, of course, is a big guy on the – Royals Twitter follow list and whatnot, and you came up with your own list, and we talked about it a little bit last week. We actually ran down the list, so we don't really have to talk about the particulars. But I'm just curious, what kind of inspired you to come up with that? And it floated around through a lot of people.
I just was really bored one night last week, and I had Darren Rovell, the CNBC sports business reporter, he eclipsed like 100,000 followers, so he came out with his 100 rules for how to use Twitter, and then he came out with his top 100 sports tweeters or whatever you want to call it. And so I was like, well, I'm bored. I might as well, put it out there. And so I just started going through my followers list. Obviously, I had the top 5 pretty well figured out, and then, filling in the 20 through 10s. And then even the top 10 was a little difficult. You made it into the top 10, sir. Congratulations.
Number 7.
That's right.
Don't want to brag or anything. But
a spot behind our missing leader tonight, Royal Man at 6, and then Greg Schaum, 5, and then on down the list to Fake Ned Yost, fake Ned our Yost. Good buddy, yeah, at number one.
He is a force to be reckoned with. And actually, he's umpiring, I forgot the event.
Is it the Ben Johnson All-Star game?
That's
yeah.
the one. So he's at the K. He's a home plate umpire tonight. So
very good.
That's pretty cool, actually. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I thought that was an interesting post that you made because, you know, this show is heavily influenced by Twitter.
It's
built by Twitter. You know, Kings of Kaufman, you know, when I took over as the lead there, Twitter was the main thing that really built the traffic and the fan base and getting things out there. And you know, I think anybody who blogs out there, sports or otherwise, if you're not on Twitter, you're
missing
really
out.
Have to. It's you know, not only is it just a good way to get your message out there, but it's a great way to like to get in touch with other people who have the similar interests and other mm-hmm. people who have good ideas who have been through it all and they've done it. So,
yeah.
I think your list is I thought it was great. The there was one omission that I didn't point out last week, but you didn't have Minda Haas on there.
Well, I put her down at the bottom as an honorable
mention
because she's in Palm Springs.
She's in Palm Springs. She's
so she hasn't really been tweeting much about the Royals. I tried to keep it as current as possible.
Right.
Of course, if this were last year, Minda would be right up there in the top five with Ranny and Fake Ned Yost and all those guys.
Yeah. Did you go to the baseball prospectus?
I did not. I just didn't flat out go.
Right.
I really wish I would have, though. You know, from what I heard, everyone was down there. Clint Scholes, all the Pine Tar Press guys, mm-hmm. all the Kings of Kaufman guys. But everyone was down there, and I really regret not going to that.
Oh, I didn't go there. I don't know. It just didn't work for me. I wanted to, but it was just, you know, things pop up.
Yep.
Anyway, recap of last show. We talked with Eric Edelstein, the general manager of the Northwest Arkansas Naturals. Really great guy to follow on Twitter as well. He's really accessible. Mm-hmm. He's really busy, but...
Yeah,
you know, he's always accessible. He's tweeting along with games. He's talking about the Royals. You know, really good guy to talk to on there. And he was a great guest on here.
I'm sure.
Yeah. So if anybody out there didn't hear last week, you want to check that out. He had a really great anecdote about the construction of Arvest Ballpark when they built that down there in Springdale, which was pretty interesting because it's kind of a bandbox as it is, and it could have been much worse if you're a pitcher at least.
Yeah.
But for today, you know, we're a week away from the trade deadline, so we're going to talk about that a little bit. There's going to be some talk of particular players, mm-hmm. especially Billy Butler, who's, you know, I you billed it earlier in the week as a Billy Butler love
Billy
fest.
Billy Butler love fest.
And in the chat room, JP's golf mom is asking who's here for the Billy Butler love fest as well.
I think everyone should have gotten their invitations on Twitter.
I know.
All day.
Yeah. So we'll get into that a little bit later. I think it's something that has been a big discussion point mm-hmm. this season. But kind of getting back into the last week, we saw some pretty good starting pitching from some guys. You know, Bruce Chen took, you know, gave Ozzie Guillen fits pretty much through eight strong innings the other night.
Oh man, I really enjoyed watching him mow him down. And Ozzie was a classic Ozzie rant after the game, and he was talking about how he didn't like his player's approach against Bruce Chen, and about how you should be, you know, kind of be impatient because Bruce Chen throws a lot of breaking stuff. So, anyways, I mean Bruce Chen just dominated him, and you know I could sense the frustration from the White Sox. Paul Konerko getting into an argument about a foul ball. Was that the game? I believe it was where Konerko gotten.
And he just kind of stood there.
Yeah.
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 You know,
but it's always fun to see the White Sox get shut down, especially by a guy like Bruce Chen. So, in my mind, I thought it was one of the better pitching performances of the entire season, and I really enjoy watching Bruce Chen pitch. He's one of those guys who Greg Shaw mentions it all the time on Twitter. He might be a guy like Jamie Moyer who just, as he goes along, he has the stuff is good enough and the command is good enough, but he has learned how to pitch, and that can mm-hmm. be a very scary thing. And you look at a guy like Brian Bannister that we had a couple years ago, just put it all together in one year. Didn't have fantastic stuff or fantastic command, but he was smart.
Yeah, and I think – that side of the game is overlooked a lot of times because, you know, you can come out there with a, you know, 100-mile arm, but, you know, if you don't know where to put it, if you don't have the command, you know, what's going to happen? I mean, look at Jeremy Jeffress, I mean, he's still got time to pick that stuff up, but, you know, electric stuff, but you can't do much with it if you're not hitting the strike zone.
Yeah, and it's good to see a guy like Chen. Everyone loves Bruce Chen. If you don't love Bruce Chen, you just don't
like baseball players. you just don't. Cause
you probably don't like babies and puppies either if you don't like Bruce Chen. I mean, the guy is probably the most eclectic Royals personality that we've had since, I don't know, Jose Lima. I mean,
maybe, yeah.
Yeah, he's just an interesting character.
Yeah, and on the line of speaking of left-handed pitchers, we always had getting some technical difficulties here. Mm-hmm. Danny Duffy is another big name, and especially with Duffy being a rookie, making his debut,
mm-hmm.
his pitching of late has been just great.
Yep.
I mean, you can't say enough about what he's doing. And, especially when you consider his first couple of starts where he was, working the pitch counts up and, having some struggles. You know, his last five or six starts, he's mm-hmm. been as good as almost any pitcher, with the exception of, the Hallidays and the Aces, Aces like that, which is really encouraging, especially that he didn't start strong and mm-hmm. then come in and kind of have problems.
I think after the St. Louis game where he struck out nine hitters in four innings or what the mm-hmm. absurd number that it was, I think he might have seen something, saying to himself, we always hear it from the baseball crowd, trusting your stuff, staying within yourself, blah, blah, blah. And maybe that's what he's doing now, because you can see it in the St. Louis game. He has the stuff where he can strike out.
Yeah.
He has that Zach Greinke electric stuff, strike out 10 per nine innings. So I'm really excited that he's put it all together now, pitching to contact, strikeouts, getting guys to pop up, jamming guys. It's really, really exciting to see Danny Duffy coming along, especially with all the concerns surrounding the starting pitching prospects in our system this year.
Yeah, it's been a rough year.
It's been a rough, rough year for our pitchers.
Pretty much everybody except Jake Odorizzi.
Yeah.
And
Duffy earlier in Omaha. That's really been the only two bright spots.
Yeah, yeah, which is kind of difficult. But his curveball was looking fantastic other night. I mean, when you can combine a 95-mile-per-hour fastball with mm-hmm. a curveball like that,
it's not even fair.
You don't even need the third pitch, but he still has it. It's a really good changeup. So we're going to go out to break. As we go out, we have Seasons of Pain. They're from Over the Park. You can follow them on Twitter at Seasons of Pain. This is their song, Evil Is, as we go to break.
Evil lives, that's evil.
welcome back to the Royal Man Report. As always, we're coming to you from the Casey Ice House at 31st and Wyandotte, Studio 4. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/Royalman. We're always going to be on kingsofcoffin.com. We're available on iTunes, iPad, iTouch, whatever you have out there. I think there are some apps for Droid that are in the works that you can get some live stream action on. Follow us on twitter.com/RoyalManReport. And let's come back into this next segment with some trade talk. We're by this time next week, the trading deadline will have passed. I think it's usually, what, 3 or 4 in the afternoon on Sunday?
I think 4 o'clock.
Something like that.
Yeah.
So
maybe 3 o'clock.
Yeah, I don't know. Who knows? Last year, the Ankiel and Farnsworth trade was announced after the deadline,
yeah.
But I think they cleared it beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
So, but last year, the Royals were really active at the trading deadline. And right now, the Royals have a lot of pieces that are attractive to contending
mm-hmm.
teams. So what do you think in this next week, what do you think the Royals' goal is going to be as far as, you know, what they're looking for, who they're looking to move, and what they want to be looking at when we start August?
I absolutely think they need to be going after starting pitching for all of the sexy names that are on this 25-man roster right now. I think for Francoeur, for Melky, for Soria, for Butler, if someone comes calling with a spectacular package to get him out of here. I think premier, not necessarily premier starting pitching, but Dayton Moore has come out and said it. We need starting pitching. We need major league ready starting pitching if
mm-hmm.
we're going to contend next year. So I think that's what it is that we need starting pitching and we need a lot of it and we need a lot of it to be ready by next year. But the question is going to be, are teams going to be willing to part with quality prospects for a player like Melky Cabrera? Let's be honest here, he's
yeah.
a major player. And then, say he goes to Philadelphia, and he's their number 7 hitter. So you have to really ease back on thinking that we're going to get a huge haul, because that
right.
never, rarely happens at the trade deadline where you get a blockbuster.
Yeah. There's not a lot of the Mark Teixeira deals
mm-hmm.
anymore. Even when Cliff Lee's been traded the last 2 times, the deals haven't been.
It was for
that
Smoke
big.
And one other guy.
Yeah,
I
it was
think.
Smoke and Mark Lowe.
Yeah.
And, you know, Justin Smoke has a lot of power, and he was a former, you know, he was, what, number 5 overall pick in 2008.
We should have picked him over Hosmer.
Oh,
jeez,
yeah.
Gosh.
You know, I remember those in 07 and 08, there was the Josh Vitters was the guy we should have taken at number 2,
mm-hmm.
apparently. And we took Moustakas, and Moustakas is Vitters is, I think he's in AAA now still.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he's not anywhere near the majors. And Hosmer, I mean, long-term, he's going to be better than Smoke.
Absolutely.
I mean, I'll just bold prediction, he's going to be better than Smoke. So Smoke might hit more 30 home run seasons, but Hosmer's going to have more 300 batting
absolutely.
Averages. Absolutely. Anyway, mm-hmm. we're getting off track.
we're way off
so,
track here.
Yeah. But as you said, you do have to kind of temper expectations as far as what you're going to get.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, teams are smarter as far as keeping their prospects now. You know, we just saw Wilson Betemeet was traded, and the Royals didn't really get a lot from him. They got Antonio Cruz, a left-handed pitcher. I think he's 19, and then they got a 21-year-old
mm-hmm.
catcher, Julio Rodriguez, and those guys are going to be in the lower levels. They're more or less lottery tickets. They're,
yeah,
you know,
I saw Will McDonald describe Cruz as a lottery ticket. If
yeah, he may or
whatever
may
you
not
get
do
from
something.
Him. Yeah,
yeah, and Betemeet wasn't playing anyway.
No,
so
the fact that we got 2 players for him, it's
yeah.
Good job, Dayton Moore. I mean,
yeah,
for a guy that played maybe 20 games this year, we got a pretty decent haul for him.
Yeah, last year at the break, you know, we brought in guys like Tim Collins, Will Smith,
mm-hmm.
who we'll talk about a little bit later, but, you know, he had the no-hitter,
mm-hmm.
or the 7 innings of the no-hitter.
Combined no-hitter.
Right, the one that actually counted.
Yeah.
And then Elisal Pimentel, who's kind of an under-the-radar prospect because
mm-hmm.
he's a little older. But, you know, we flipped Rick Ankiel and Kyle Farnsworth and Scott Podsednik and Alberto Callaspo for those kind of guys.
Yep.
And, you know, they're not, you know, nobody's going to confuse Will Smith with some kind of an ace. He's maybe a number 5 starter at
mm-hmm.
best. But, he's 6'5". He doesn't walk a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
You can still get quality guys at the deadline. So, you know, someone like Melky, the Phillies have been rumored to be around him. Also, I think the Angels and the Giants have been.
Yeah.
linked to him, and he's having a career year. I mean,
absolutely.
I am surprised as anybody else the year that Melky Cabrera is having, but how many teams out there are going to buy it?
Exactly. I think as a 26-year-old, if I were a GM of a team and I saw a player like Melky Cabrera, who had always had with the Yankees, he was, you know, a pretty decent prospect, mm-hmm. and then, you know, goes to Atlanta and just basically falls on his face, and mm-hmm. the Royals pick him up off the scrap heap for pennies on the dollar.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's 26 years old, and he's having a great career. He's on a great year, and he's on pace for 20 home runs, 100 RBIs, playing pretty good defense in the outfield. So if I'm a GM, I think Melky Cabrera is a pretty attractive player, mm-hmm. signed through next year.
Switch hitter,
doesn't have to play center field, can play all three outfield positions. And I would say the only knock on him that I have is that he hasn't really shown great on-base skills, but he's still, mm-hmm. he'll walk, and he's no Unieski Betancourt. But for me, I think Melky should be attractive to quite a few teams. It's just what are they going to be willing to part with.
Right, yeah, and the Royals might – there's talk that they don't want to trade both Melky and mm-hmm. Jeff Francoeur, and Francoeur was traded last year around this time and, you know, served as kind of a platoon guy. Yeah. And I think he'd be really effective in that role mm-hmm. for, you know, someone who has a younger, light-hitting, you know, guy who's not that good against righties mm-hmm. or something, you know, or not that good against lefties. But I don't know that even if they wanted to trade them both, they would be able to, because I think they want more than they're going to get.
Yeah.
And, you know, they have options on both these guys. Melky's 26. Francoeur's only 27. It seems like he'd mm-hmm. be older with, you know, all the talk about, you know, being a clubhouse guy and, you know, his kind of resume.
Yeah.
You know, but he's been in the league since he was 21.
Yeah.
So he's been around a while, but he's still relatively young. And I don't know if the Royals are going to get everything for them, but and they could still flip him for whoever, and they could just be, you know, building their own market, and they're mm-hmm. completely fine with trading him. Who knows?
Yeah.
But some other guys that could draw some interest, you know, we talked about Soria, and I think he's probably the most attractive guy out there, and especially with the bullpen that the Royals have now. Greg Holland, if he doesn't end up starting somehow next year or whatever, he could be a closer. He's got closer stuff.
He is nasty.
Yeah, I don't. Who said it? Someone said he needed a bath because he's filthy. I don't know if it was you or his.
No, it wasn't me last night.
But
he's been outstanding.
Yeah.
Last night was the first time he allowed a run at home this year in like 12 appearances. He's just an outstanding pitcher, a 10th round pick, and a guy. Who we're getting off topic again, but I'll be quick on Greg Holland. He's just one of my favorites. Keith Blackburn, Double Sticks on Twitter.
Uh-huh.
He's been high on him since last year and since he started coming up through the system, and boy, he just shaved a couple miles per hour off of his fastball, and he's just been outstanding. And he can still dial it up to 98-99.
Yeah, which is that's dangerous when you got a guy who can mix speeds like that, and you have him, you know, for one inning, and all he has to do is get those outs.
Mm-hmm.
And we're seeing it this year. So the Royals have an opportunity to trade Soria if they want to.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was Ken Rosenthal or John Morosi or one of the national writers. They had talked to Dayton Moore, and they had quoted him as saying he wanted two major league ready or close to major league ready pitchers. And, you know, the Royals and Soria always get linked to the Yankees. So, I mean, names like Manny Benuelos and Betances, what's his first name? I should know, but I don't know. But, you know, it's two of their top pitching prospects out of the Yankees. I don't know if they'd give that much, but the Royals have all the cards in the Soria situation.
Mm-hmm.
They've got, you know, a team-friendly contract with options. They have no real reason to trade him if they don't want to. If they don't get a deal that knocks them out, they'll just keep him.
I think the only reason you would ever trade Soria is the old stat head philosophy that bad teams don't even need a closer. You just do a closer by committee, and which kind of sucks because Soria has been spectacular in his career with the Royals. I mean, he's by far my favorite Royals pitcher that's stuck around besides Zach Greinke. I love watching Joaquin Soria pitch. He struggled this year, but like, I mean, God, I'm going to use the word attractive so many times tonight because it's a trade deadline. Get used to it. But he is – there have to be so many teams interested in him. Not so many teams, but any team with bullpen trouble, and a lot of teams do have it. Mm-hmm. We're very lucky here that we have a solid bullpen. I think Soria should be shopped pretty heavily, and I think – if you can get a if you can get a good package for him, you have to pull the trigger.
Yeah, if it's something that looks too good to be true, you got to go for it, because they do have the arms that, you know, and even guys coming up, Kelvin Herrera and, you know, Patrick Keating's been off and on, but he's, you know, another
Greg Billow, another guy.
Yeah, he's, you know, maybe a year or two off, but still the Royals are kind of a year or two off.
Yeah.
So
perpetually.
Hopefully that comes to an end soon, but. Yeah. You know, I think they can trade him. I don't really want them to, because at the same time, he's also an elite guy.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't really throw hard like most closers, and it's kind of like Mariano Rivera. You might get some longevity out of him, but at the same time, it's kind of a luxury.
Yeah.
So, you know, you get into that, and I think there's even a random stat, you know, like 70% of replacement level pitchers could get three outs before they give up three runs.
Yeah.
So it goes along with that closing segment, but we're going to go to break here. We'll probably talk some more about trade candidates, because there are a couple others. As we go to break, here's another song by Seasons of Pain. This is their song called Psycho Bitch. Welcome back to the Royalman Report. Once again, we're doing a little bit of trade discussion, but first I want to throw out the credit to Seasons of Pain, who is providing the music for our breaks this week. We've got one more song from them in the next break.
It's a pretty good name for a Royals podcast.
It really is.
Seasons of Pain.
I was thinking that.
Maybe a Royals blog. I might start a new one.
Yeah,
Seasons of Pain, a Royals blog.
Might hop on GoDaddy and pick that one up now. We're here at Studio 4 at 31st and Wyandotte in the KC Ice House. My name is Mike Engel. I'm from Kings of Kaufman. I'm joined by Brian McGannon, who you can find at royalskingdom.blogspot.com.
Correct.
You can also follow him at Brian McGannon. You can follow me at Michael Engel. You can follow the Royalman Report at Royalman Report. Looking at the chat room, getting some activity in here, talking about Melky not being not getting enough of return to trade him. JakeDog79 says, I say keep them both, meaning Francoeur and Melky.
Mm-hmm.
And Francoeur can be the fourth outfielder after the All-Star break and next year. Or try the last 20 years of pain, which, okay. So that's kind of the idea is, you know, we don't know what we're going to get for these guys. I think we can still get something for them.
Yeah.
And especially guys like, you know, Jeff Francis, who we didn't talk about in the last segment, and Bruce Chen, who we didn't talk about as far as like a trade candidate. But, you know, those guys are veteran left-handers. You know, they're not necessarily going to be dominant guys. They're not guys you're going to send out there if you need a clinching game, but mm-hmm. they're guys who down the stretch, the last 2 months of the season, can really play a good role yeah. on a team that might have some injuries or might have some younger players that aren't used to that
mm-hmm.
kind of pressure situations. And they're left-handers.
Yeah.
And there's always a market for left-handed
always.
Pitching. Especially with Francis, who's, you know, he's been hit a little bit, but his control has been great. He's
yeah.
walking less than 2/9.
Yeah.
So every time he goes out there, you can pretty much figure he's only going to walk one, maybe two guys.
Yeah. And you know you're going to get six innings out of him. He's
right.
He's been the classic innings eater. He's just
right.
gone out there. He'll strike a few guys out. He won't walk any guys. He'll might put you in a bit of a jam because, you know, his stuff isn't that great.
Right.
So I think Francis, there's probably a couple teams interested. I've heard the Cardinals have a little bit of interest in him, and I wouldn't mind ripping the Cardinals off.
Right, yeah,
for,
let's
take
some kind of like top 20 prospect
yeah,
from him for a guy
that'd be pretty nice.
You know, was gonna give them 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he's also affordable. I mean, they've got 2 months from him, and he's making less than $1 million the rest of the way.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if somebody's concerned about payroll, well,
yeah,
there you go. I mean, that's mm-hmm. kind of the best of everything. Left-handed pitcher, good control, and he's not going to strain your
yeah.
your bankroll.
And I think the Royals need to be targeting teams like the Diamondbacks and Pirates, who kind of
oh, yeah.
might be thinking that they can get it done this year. Obviously, I'm pulling for the Pirates. I'm not
right.
sending any ill will towards them because that could very well be us next year.
Exactly.
But that's got to be a team who thinks that they are just one move away from pushing themselves over the top and gaining that extra inch in the
mm-hmm.
in the race, and maybe the Royals could benefit from that desperation or and get a better deal above market. So,
yeah, those two teams kind of remind me of the Royals in 2003,
yeah.
when you know we thought we were in it and went and got Brian Anderson and got Rondell White. You know, we didn't trade anybody of consequence. I don't think
yeah.
we traded anybody
no.
who panned out to anything.
Interesting, a quick note on Rondell White. He yeah. had, like, 15 outstanding games. He hit, like, 350
oh, yeah.
for us,
like
and then he got hurt.
Yeah, had, like, a 1.4 OPS.
Yeah, oh, he was great.
Four homers or six
yeah.
homers, and just, and then, yeah, got hurt.
Got hurt, and unfortunately, that was the end of his career, too.
Was it?
Well, maybe he played a year or two more.
There, yeah.
But he was riddled with injuries.
Being an effective guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, Brian Anderson, I think, pitched the next year and was
he was our opening day starter in 2004
yeah.
and gave up 7 runs in 4 innings, I think.
Lovely, yeah. Well, that's...
So, tales of caution for those of
yeah.
you
but
Pirates fans out there.
But Jeff Francis is a good guy, so if you've got someone to send to us, we'll take
yeah.
him.
And he's Canadian, so...
Right.
Diversity.
Right, yeah. Bruce Chen's another guy I think could be really good, and he's... You know, so many other teams have tried him out, and he's
mm-hmm.
a guy who can start for you. He can pitch out of the bullpen, you know, and he's also a guy who's comfortable in either role.
Mm-hmm.
So it gives somebody some versatility if maybe they're, you know, maybe the Braves could use him for something.
Yeah.
You know, especially if they're going to be facing the Phillies and you got Ryan Howard and Chase
yep.
Utley. You know, you want to neutralize those guys. If you want a guy who can just fill in if he needs to, you know, Bruce Chen's a good guy for that.
Mm-hmm.
And really, I think for those guys, a lot of, like, my stance is if you're going to be trading these guys, you want to be able to get something for them. But it's also a way to open up some spots for other
yeah.
guys. because, you know, you've got Lorenzo Cain and David Lowe back in Omaha, and they're both playing extremely well. I think they're both deserving of a shot in Kansas City, but, you know, it's Frank Hoare and Melky have definitely been deserving of their playing time. And I can't, you know, I want to complain that they're playing all the time, but they're doing it.
Yeah. I mean, they are both doing what they were brought in here to do. Melky has been a great surprise. We already talked about him. Frenchie is hitting home runs, leading the team in RBIs. He's being the offensive juggernaut that he was in Atlanta. Maybe not as great as far as batting average and on base percentage, but still hitting the extra base hits. He had quite the prolonged slump about a couple weeks ago, but I think he's been outstanding. Not outstanding, but very much what I hoped for him to be, which was a guy who could hit 20 to 22, 23 home runs. But I'm hoping we can get those guys out of here, because I really do want to see Lorenzo Cain, and I really do want to see David Lowe up here, guys who we have brought into the system and, you know, molded and shaped into the players we want them to be. And we always hear the David DeJesus comparisons with Lowe, and I'm not too sure if I want to jump on that train yet, but maybe here's the thing. Do you want a David DeJesus or do you want a Jeff Francoeur? That's, you know, you got to make your choice.
Yeah, that's a tough call, because they give you different things, and I think it's kind of a, you know, such a balanced player like DeJesus, and David Lowe's kind of that same guy. He's not he's a jack of all trades, master of none. It's that kind of thing. But with Lorenzo Cain, he's another guy who's just a natural athlete. Like, he didn't even play baseball until he was a junior in high school.
Unbelievable.
So, and he's got 11 homers in Omaha. He's hitting 300. You know, he plays great defense, good range. And he was a big part of the Greinke trade, too. Mm-hmm. So I think that might be a little bit of incentive. But you also want to be able to try to move some guys to get those guys up. You know, I wonder if Chris Getz would get anything on the open market, because
a bag of balls.
Well, he's mistake free though. He's a mistake free ball player.
That is one of the most frustrating statements I've ever heard Dayton Moore ever say. And this is also the guy who told us that we were gonna have a parade on the plaza 5 years ago. It's also the guy that said Betancourt was the best prospect in the history of whatever. Or maybe that was a different guy in the Royals organization, but whatever. To say that he's a mistake-free player is, I don't want to call it blasphemy or hyperbole, it's just absolutely asinine to say that a guy like Chris Getz is a mistake-free player. If mistakes are extra base hits, then absolutely he's a mistake-free player. If mistakes are hitting the ball out of the infield, then yes, he's a mistake-free player. Chris Getz, who I had the chance to meet on Friday night, a very nice guy, but I have the ability to separate a person's personal life from their professional life. And if you suck at your job and there's someone who can be much better at your job than Johnny Giovitella, then why are they I have good reason to be pissed off about it. Here's my my problem with Chris Getz is, there's this misnomer out there that he is this defensive stud. When we got him, that was the word on him. He's great defense. He'll get on base. He's got a little bit of pop. And he's just been none of it. He's just been the very definition of a replacement level player.
Yeah, he's a slap hitter. I mean, he can't take some walks, but it's not somebody who his defense is that. It's not like Elcides Escobar when he was hitting 200. Where Escobar's defense is enough to get you to where you're actually, his defense is balancing out the bad bat. Getz doesn't have that kind of luxury.
Yeah.
He's a 30 bat with a 40 glove,
yeah.
Whereas, you know, Escobar's maybe a 30 bat with a 70 glove on that 20 to 80 scale. So it's just not worth it, especially when you've got a guy like Giovitella who has been the hottest hitter in professional baseball over the last 2 months.
Yeah.
And that's not, you know, that's not hyperbole. That's not hype. That's just what it is. He's got more hits than any other hitter in professional baseball.
32 doubles this year.
Yeah.
Not extra base hits. 30 doubles this year. Chris Getz has 32 extra base hits in his career.
Yeah.
So I mean, just to give you some perspective about what kind of player each guy is, Chris Getz is the epitome of this gritty, determined, just in the GM's eye, baseball guy, baseball player, whatever. The Joe McEwing, of the 2010s.
Yeah, David Howard.
Yeah, David Howard.
You know, those guys who just they're gonna play hard. And it's like, that's fine.
David Eckstein. He's gonna go into the hole. Well, that's great. He has not a lot of athletic ability, and he's not very good at much except stealing bases, which. Fine, great. Stolen base is kind of an overrated stat anyways.
Yeah, I mean, I worked hard when I was trying out for baseball in high school.
Yeah.
It didn't matter because I couldn't hit. So, it's the same thing.
I just worry, we were talking about it during the break too, I just worry that we're going to encounter the same kind of situation that we saw with Jason Kendall last year. But the thing is, Jason Kendall didn't have anybody pushing him, so it was kind of like, damned if you do, damned if you don't with Kendall.
Yeah.
But now with Getz, it's just, damned if you do. You're only hurting the future of this franchise if you insist on keeping Getz here. And then Dayton Moore also said he doesn't think that Giavitel is going to be up here anytime soon.
Yeah, I don't get that. It's not like Chris Getz is a young guy either. He's 27, so you know the upside's pretty limited there. But we're going to head out to break. When we get back, we're going to do maybe a little bit of minor league stuff, but mostly I'll be honest with you, we're going to talk Billy Butler.
Yes!
So, it's the Love Fest.
Yes!
As we go out, Seasons of Pain with their song Grave is what you'll be listening to. Welcome back to the Royalman Report. My name is Mike Engel. We are coming to you from Kansas City, Missouri, Studio 4 at 31st and Wyandotte in the Casey Ice House. I am joined by Brian McGannon, and the Royalman is out doing his roller derby emceeing, so he is out for the night. But you can follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/Royalman Report. Follow us on Facebook, facebook.com/Royalman. And every week we come to you live on kingsofkaufman.com. We were talking about Chris Getz and, you know, his mistake-free billing, I guess. which is just not right. Mm. And I don't think we need to get into that anymore just because it's frustrating. But as far as frustrating things, as a fan, I understand that people are going to have their opinions on players.
Absolutely.
And that's fine. That's great. That's what you want from a fan base. And Kansas City fans are passionate and they're dedicated. But for some reason, and I don't know why, Billy Butler has come under fire for basically not hitting home runs,
mm-hmm.
which it's fair. He only had 7 home runs this year.
Yeah.
But I think it's one of those things where, and we've talked about it before on here, I've talked about it on Kings of Kauffman, you and I have talked about it on Twitter, Jeff Parker coined us Team Billy, which if you're a Billy Butler supporter, hashtag Team Billy, and let it ride. The thing is, with this thing, the criticisms are that Billy Butler doesn't have power, that he only hits singles, that he doesn't do anything on offense. And this year, I'll admit he's having a down year, but his down year is .285 and a .400 on base percentage. So,
and a .410 slugging percentage.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he's still carrying an OPS that's higher than league average.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's still one of those guys that, you know, he's struck out as many times as he's walked, and he's walked 50 times. He's only struck out 50.
And I think that he walked 50 times his rookie year. So yeah. His walks are getting better.
Yeah, I mean, it's a weird balance that, you know, you want. He's the kind of guy that teams should want to have and fans should want to have
mm-hmm.
on their team. I think the criticism with him is he's a guy who's 6'2 and 240. He's a big guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's slow. I mean,
yeah,
you can time him with a calendar, I think somebody said. But somebody with those kind of skills, he's got great hands, a great batting eye, makes contact, and hits line drives. You want that on your team. And I think people want to see him as this big player, and they want to see him hitting home runs
mm-hmm.
like other big guys like Jose Bautista, and David Ortiz yeah. is a really big guy, Ryan Howard, Prince Fielder, other really big guys. But they hit the ball out. You know, they hit 50-some homers.
Yeah.
Butler's never been that guy.
Mm-mm.
But what he does give you is the kind of production that works in other ways. He hits a lot of doubles. From 2008 to 2009, nobody else had more doubles than Billy Butler.
Mm-hmm.
And that's while he was also increasing his walk rate and, you know, reducing his strikeouts. You know, it's an approach that got him through. He was a first-round pick out of high school. And, you know, why would you change your approach?
I mean, everyone out there knows I think Billy Butler is one of, if not the best young hitter in the game. Maybe I would put him on the level of a Troy Tulowitzki, an Evan Longoria, those young players. Maybe not. Okay, I overstepped the comparison a little bit, but he's still 25. And
right.
You have to, the Royals are at a point where they can afford to be patient this year with him.
Mm-hmm.
And as his career has gone on, you can see he puts things together as each season progresses. His first year,
right.
He just was Billy. He hit doubles. He hit for average. And then the next year, he had that huge power year where he had that ridiculous stat, 20 home runs, 50 doubles.
Yeah.
And something else that only Albert Pujols, Matt Holliday,
oh, yeah.
and Miguel Cabrera, and it was just like a laundry
Hank
list.
Greenberg, I think.
Was yeah, it was just a laundry list of Hall of Famers. And he did it. And then last year, you know, kind of saw him slide off a little bit. But his doubles numbers stayed the same,
mm-hmm.
and you saw his on-base percentage improve. And then this year, it's for him, it's been all about the walk. And he has been hitting into terrible luck this year.
Oh yeah, was it today?
It was
right
the hardest
Longoria.
Hit ball all game, right at Evan Longoria.
Yeah.
And it's just been, and you had that. He's been at the plate so many times with a chance to win the game, and he's done it once. He had a walk off home run against the Angels.
Yeah.
And then I believe it was against the White Sox. It was a couple weeks ago, and he hit a pretty hard line drive that just found its way to the outfielder. And I'm not trying to make excuses for Billy, but he is 25 years old,
mm-hmm.
and you got to think Melky Cabrera is 26 years old, and look at the year that he's having this year.
Right.
You have to give these guys time Billy is under a very club-friendly contract. But that contract gets a pretty significant jump in the next few years. So if the production is not there, obviously you will start to see even more hate towards Billy.
Right.
And obviously some of it stems from this belief that he's not a very nice guy or doesn't enjoy being a baseball player, doesn't enjoy Kansas City. And that, you know, when he swung and missed at that pitch on the walk-off wild pitch.
Yeah.
And people are like, he wasn't even in the celebration. The guy just swung at a pitch 5 feet out of the strike
zone. That he knew he shouldn't be swinging at.
And he was mad at himself, obviously. He is a perfectionist. He is an artist of hitting. And he takes great pride in his work. He is going to be a professional hitter until he walks away from this game. So I can't blame him for being mad and not really being a full-on celebration. So.
Yeah, and another part of the criticism is that he doesn't get a lot of RBIs, which RBIs are just an iffy stat anyway, because what you've got to have to get an RBI, you have to be up with a runner on base. Mm-hmm. You have to have somebody who you can drive in. And, you know, when you've got Alex Gordon hitting leadoff most of the time, you've got Melky Cabrera who's having a career year, there's not that many players who are still on base for him to drive in because they've already been driven in.
Mm-hmm. And especially with Frank Coor batting in front of him for most of the year, that's probably where that stems from.
Yeah, and it's, you know, because
he drives all of them in.
That's just one knock on him. And, and I guess it's valid in a way because, you look at the numbers and he does have less RBIs. That's fine, but, you know, there's context to that. And then RBIs isn't a great stat anyway.
Yeah, it's more of a team stat than a player stat. It's it's a lineup stat. I'm sure you could go down through the lineup on every Major League Baseball team. And, like, last year, Unieski Betancourt led the team in RBIs for a majority of the season. And it was because he was hitting behind, I believe it was Avila.
He was usually hitting, like, eighth or ninth. He was getting guys who would just get up and get on base.
I've just blacked last year out of my memory, so I can't. I can't really remember who he was hitting behind, but I think it was Avilas and a couple other guys. It's gonna haunt me forever. But anyways, Uni was hitting eighth and ninth, and he was just getting chances to drive runners in, and so it's a completely. It's a chance stat, and obviously people will point, well, runner average with runners in scoring position. That's not it's not like the player goes to the bench and says, all right, get out there on the field. It's a matter of chance when you're going to get your shot at driving in runs. And Billy just really – he really hasn't gotten a lot this year. He has not had – he's had an average amount, but not for the kind of player – he is.
Yeah, if you show me a player who can will themselves to hit better and with runners in scoring position, why aren't they doing it with runners with, you know, the bases empty?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
Chris Getz.
Right. Oh, he's great with runners in scoring position. But,
he's
I don't know.
At everything else.
Yeah.
Except stealing bases.
Right.
Love those steals.
Right, and he dives really well for that ball to his left. So that's great. I'm going to read off just some stats because, you know, we are talking about stats.
Nerds. We love numbers.
Right. Here's a guy who's got, you know, in his career, or for the first 5 years of his career, 124 doubles, 42 homers, 292 RBIs, you know, .308 batting average, .806 OPS, 1,060 total bases. Who's complaining about that guy? Because that guy is George Brett.
Mm-hmm.
And George Brett was never really a power guy. But he was a guy who hit the ball hard, hit the ball well, and if it went over the fence, great.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but he never took the – he never wanted to hit home runs. He never tried to hit homers. I'm sure he could have probably tried to pull the ball more, could have hit 40 homers a couple times.
Yep. He coined the famous term, don't try to hit the ball far, try to hit it hard.
Yeah.
And I think that's what every player – it's just like such a great hitting quip. I mean – I have I've always thought the Brett Butler comparisons were not really fair, but I thought I can see there's merit to it. I mean, and then when you look at things that Brett had that Butler doesn't, speed.
Right.
If Butler had Brett's speed, imagine how many of those little dribblers that he hits would be base hits.
It's true.
Mm-hmm. And then the one more thing about Butler, the biggest knock on him that I see the most is the double plays. And I'm going to give you a little baseball geek homework tonight, folks.
All right.
You go to MajorLeagueBaseball.com. You go look up the career leaders for grounded into double plays. You write down the 25 names that it shows, and then go find out how many of them are in the Hall of Fame. Here's a hint. All 25 of them are in the Hall of Fame.
Wow.
So it's not – it's an unfortunate stat. It's not a bad stat. Carl Yastrzemski, Roberto Clemente, Hank Aaron, all those guys are on there. George Brett's on there. I mean, those good hitters put the ball in play, and that's all that a ground into double play is. It's bad luck. It's unfortunate. But it's a sign of a good hitter.
Yeah, they're coming up. They're usually batting probably third or fourth.
Mm-hmm.
People
on base.
Got a guy on first.
On first.
They're hitting the ball hard, but they hit it right at somebody, mm-hmm. and that's tailor-made for a double play. That's where the phrase comes from.
Mm-hmm.
So, and Billy Butler, to compare to George Brett's stats, and I'm not trying to say that Billy Butler's going to be the next George Brett, but I'm just saying their numbers are comparable.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to complain that Billy Butler can't produce, you've got to give that same criticism to George Brett. Nobody's going to do that. Plus, when you look at the lineup that Brett had, he had Lee Mayberry on that team in some of those years. You know, Amos Otis was in a couple of those seasons.
Mm-hmm.
Frank White. Well, I don't think Frank White was there yet.
I think
maybe a year or so. This is 73 to 77. But anyway, Butler has an 812 OPS, which is higher than Brett's.
Mm-hmm.
He has 41 more doubles than Brett.
And George Brett was known as the greatest doubles hitter in the 80s.
Yeah, yeah. 19 more homers, drove in more runs. He walked 65 more times than George Brett. So I don't know, you know, if you're going to complain about Butler, you've got to give that same.
But George Brett was cute. All the girls loved him.
He was the guy from
California. He was cute. Everybody loved him.
Butler's from Florida.
He did Miller. He did beer commercials. Everyone loves a guy who does beer commercials. It's a public perception of Butler that he should be the guy, and he's 25 years old. Give him time. We've got him under contract for 3 more years after this year. He's gonna come around, and if he doesn't, when the contract jumps, then I might jump over to Team Not Billy or Team Belly or whatever Belly Butler.
If in 2 years.
Is what I've heard him get called.
Yeah, if in 2 years he's still not, if he's still floating around and he's a lot of just batting average, at that point maybe it's fair.
Mm-hmm.
But for right now, a lot of players don't hit their peak until they're about 27 or 28 as far as developing power. And I think Billy, if he wants to hit homers, he could hit homers. Mm-hmm. I just don't think he wants to.
I brought it up. It could be a thing with Kevin Seitzer. Kevin Seitzer's idea seems to be, or philosophy seems to be, drive the ball back through the middle, go the other way. But I think Butler needs someone who's going to really work with him on driving the ball to left.
All right. It's time to close it up, as you know by that sound.
It was a good time.
Yeah, yeah. Just a quick note, next week we will be having Jason Adam, who is with the Kane County Cougars. He was the fifth-round pick last year, guy from Blue Valley Northwest. I also want to give props to Will Smith and Kelvin Herrera, who combined for a no-hitter at Northwest Arkansas. Luis Mendoza.
Too bad.
Threw a no-hitter. I don't like the reverse decision, but that's what it is, so that's the rule.
Life's cruel.
I want to give props to Brian for coming out here and talking some baseball.
Mm-hmm.
Also, thanks to Aaron Gnerk, our producer, who we don't give enough credit because he fixes all the weird glitches that pop up. Give us a call. Find us at Royalman Report on Twitter. Talk to us. Leave us messages. We got to get going. Thanks for listening. Have a good night. Mm-hmm.